Well, good morning, colleagues, and welcome to the third meeting of the Finance Committee. As is the case with committees, changes in membership take place, and we have experienced some changes since our last meeting. I'd like to pay particular tribute to Mike Russell, who did a lot of work to establish this committee as its convener, and also Kate Forbes for her robust contributions in our first two meetings. We have, therefore, two new members to replace those who have resigned from the committee. I'd like to welcome Bruce Crawford and Mary Todd to the committee formally, and give them the opportunity to declare any relevant interests. Bruce, do you have any relevant interests?
I have no relevant interests to declare. Thank you.
Mary Todd, do you have any relevant interests?
No, I have no relevant interest to declare.
Thank you very much, and welcome to the committee. The second item I have to attend to is the choice of a new convener. I would like, therefore, to make it clear that under the agreement, the new convener will be a member of the Scottish National Party. And with that said, I would like to invite nominations for the post of convener of the Finance Committee. Mr. Coffey.
Thank you. I'd like to nominate my friend and colleague, Bruce Crawford, MSP, to chair the committee for this session.
Thank you very much. Bruce Crawford is formally nominated. Are there any other nominations? If there are no further nominations, it is therefore my pleasure to say that ask if we're all agreed that Bruce Crawford should be the convener of this committee. Thank you very much.
Thank members for the support and say how much I'm looking forward to working with members, obviously working with indeed the Cabinet Secretary of Finance and Constitution himself in the coming months. We have a lot of work ahead of us. No doubt there'll be some significant challenges we've got to take on as well. But I think, as you'll find, as always, I'll try to put the integrity of the committee to the fore. So let's go on with the business in hand. And the first business in hand is item number three. To decide whether we will take item 5 in private. We all agreed we'll take item 5 in private? That's unanimously agreed. Thank you very much. We're now going to agenda item 4. It consists of taking evidence from Derek Mackay, MSP, the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and Constitution. And Mr. Mackay is accompanied by three officials: Alistair Brown, the Acting Director of Financial Strategy; Scott Mackay, who's the Deputy Director of Financial Programme Management; and Andrew Watson, who's the Deputy Director for Financial Strategy. Thank you and welcome to all. Cabinet Secretary, I understand you wish to make an opening statement.
Yes.
I ask you to do that now, please?
Thank you and good morning. It's a pleasure to be with you and offer my congratulations to you, Convener, on your first meeting as Convener of the Finance Committee. There is a strong record of cooperation between the Scottish Government and the Finance Committee, and as a former member, I'm looking forward to strengthening that relationship as we enter a new fiscal environment. As I've said before, the work we'll do together over this parliamentary term will be of real and lasting significance. We need to work together to address challenges in the public finances. The 2015 UK spending review delivered another tight budget settlement. The discretionary resource budget will fall in real terms, and while the capital budget will increase slightly, it remains significantly lower than its peak in 2009-10. We don't know yet what the impact of the autumn statement will have on those funding totals, but we do know that the Chancellor has said he'll use the opportunity to reset economic policy. In terms of the fiscal and constitutional outlook, we are in uncharted territory. The implementation of the Scotland Act 2016 is clearly going to be a key issue for Government and the Finance Committee, and there is good ground for us to build upon. Our plans for using the powers in the Act were set out in the Programme for Government published just yesterday, and the issues presented by the EU referendum will be a key interest to this committee. As well as looking at the strategic perspective for the next 5 years, we have decisions to take in the short term about this year's budget process. I restate that I believe these to be exceptional circumstances, and I'm grateful to the committee for considering these issues I've raised in the past discussion, and I hope that my letter of last week has been helpful in addressing the range of questions that you have had. My priority remains to ensure that the 17-18 draft budget reflects as accurately as possible the implications for public spending in Scotland following the EU referendum. The accumulation of risk and uncertainty for the Scottish budget, which will not be resolved until this year's autumn statement is published, leads me to propose holding back the draft budget for clarity. I'm also happy to offer to take other steps early in the autumn to support the committee's scrutiny ahead of the budget by exploring what additional material the Scottish Government could provide to the committee before publication of the draft budget. It would of course be possible for committees to begin taking evidence from stakeholders on the budget to examine priorities and financial issues in their areas of interest, and I would be happy to support that. I also understand the desire for intense budget scrutiny when published, and would be flexible in supporting that also, more frequent meetings, for example. Looking beyond this year's process, I remain very supportive of proposals to establish a joint working group to look at the future of the budget process, and we'd be happy to discuss that today too. Convener, I'll offer a couple of remarks about the EU referendum as it relates to financial matters. As I set out in my letter of last week, with respect to understanding the impact of the EU referendum outcome, there is no precedent. The EU referendum outcome has created a great deal of uncertainty, not just in Scotland and the UK, but across Europe as a whole. And whilst the UK government's confirmation that they will guarantee in the short term some of the elements of the European expenditure, that's helped to an extent, I'd like them to go further, particularly with regards to EU structural funds, Scottish Rural Development Programme projects and European Maritime Fisheries projects that begin after the autumn statement, for whom there is no certainty at this stage. And we're of course engaging with Treasury to find a way forward. We believe the best immediate course of action for Scotland's economy is to support our businesses, which is why we've announced plans to inject a further £100 million of spending this financial year into a range of capital infrastructure projects, and businesses will also be provided with wider support to help them navigate in these uncertain times. Finally, I should confirm that there remains considerable uncertainty around the prospect for the Chancellor's autumn statement, both in terms of the economic forecasts that the OBR will be developing and the response the UK government will take in terms of public finances. And I will continue to engage with Treasury to seek clarity about these issues, working where relevant with colleagues from Wales and Northern Ireland. Where we are also pursuing and continuing to progress the detailed implementation of the revised fiscal framework, and as I said in my letter, I would be happy to keep the committee updated on this as we go forward. Happy to take questions on any of those matters.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. You mentioned in your opening statement that the Scottish Government, and I hope I get the terminology right here, said you would produce and publish, or prepare to consider producing and publishing, additional information that would help the committee with scrutiny of the budget. In that process, would you be happy for your officials and the clerks of the committee to sit down following this discussion? If that's what the committee want, would you be happy to sit down with your officials to have a discussion with the clerks about what that might contain and what elements might be in that to help the process?
Of course I would. And I think that would be in the spirit of the discussions that we've had. I recognise that members want to pursue and probe the budget issues. I also want that work to be accurate, and therefore I would support that process by allowing officials to engage as constructively as possible, of course.
Okay, I've got just one other area I'd like to explore, and as you probably know, Cabinet Secretary, I'm new to this committee, and I'm trying to improve my understanding of some of the processes. But it is my understanding the Scottish Government publishes a budget before the autumn statement, that the Scottish Government would be reliant upon UK macroeconomic data published by the OBR in March in producing tax forecasts for 2017-18, obviously pre-Brexit. Given that, to what extent do you think you'll be able to take into account the impact of Brexit on tax forecasts? But the important bit of my question is, what role will the Scottish Fiscal Commission play in that? And have you had any discussions with the Scottish Fiscal Commission around the preparing forecasts without post-Brexit data?
So I'll cover some of that and maybe ask Alistair to talk more about the engagement with the Fiscal Commission. In terms of our work, in these early days, as we begin to work on our own infrastructure, we are still relying on OBR to inform UK government decisions, and the Fiscal Commission will provide oversight to our figures, our workings, before they actually take up their fuller responsibilities to produce their own forecasts. And they are aware of the direction of travel that I wish to take the budget process in. There have been good constructive discussions around that, but we are all reliant at this stage on the OBR's forecast, which will drive the UK government's autumn statement, which then informs our budget process. But Alistair may want to add to that in terms of the specifics of engagement.
Well, I think you've made the key points, Minister, and just to confirm that we are speaking to colleagues in the Scottish Fiscal Commission about the scrutiny and reporting work that they will have to do, as the Minister has said, on the forecasts that we'll produce in respect of 17-18 and the timing of that work to ensure that they're ready to respond to whatever eventual timing is decided. And just to make clear that as from with respect to forecasts for 18-19 onwards, it will be the Fiscal Commission itself that does that forecasting work in line with the statutory responsibilities set out in the Act passed by the Parliament this March.
Now, I've got a number of members who want to ask questions around, understandably, around timing issues. I'm going to come in a minute to Alec Johnston to begin that session. But just to get the picture full before we begin that, Willie Coffey, I understand you had a question about what discussions have been going on between the UK government and the Scottish government. That'll give us a whole picture, I think, before we get into, or a bigger picture, before we get into the timing issues.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Just to explore a wee bit with you what the relationship you're currently having with your counterpart, the Chancellor. You said in your own remarks there that he's already said he's about to reset economic policy. Is he aware of the impact that the lateness and the delay and the potential change in the autumn statement, the significance of it, is going to have on all of the devolved administrations?
I think that's a very fair question. So on taking up the post, I engaged with the previous Chancellor, George Osborne, who indicated, of course, that there would be a likely scenario of an emergency budget. Well, that hasn't transpired, and now everything has been put into the Chancellor's autumn statement. Both the previous Chancellor and the current Chancellor, in the engagements that I've had with them, have said that there would be an adjustment, new Chancellor has described it as resetting economic policy. And I did write to the Chancellor, of course, and explain the difficulties that it causes us in not having clarity around our position. And I did try and tease out what the timescales would be for his autumn statement and the contents therein. I have had a reply I'm happy to share with the committee. But it doesn't actually take the issue forward because I've got no further clarity on timescales other than what we already understand through precedent of late November, early December, and nothing of substance as to what might be in the Chancellor's statement, which leaves us in the same position as was before. But of course I've expressed the difficulties that causes this Parliament and the Government to take forward our budget. We're not alone in that. In terms of the other devolved administrations, Northern Ireland will not produce a budget pre-autumn statement either. So I think all devolved administrations are pursuing the Chancellor on clarity. I've also looked through the statements and the questions that the Chancellor has made in the House of Commons on questions, and it holds his current position that there will be a financial adjustment, it will reset economic policy, but he's giving nothing away. So I'm sorry I can't be more helpful, but I'm afraid in this respect I'm in the hands of the Chancellor.
Has he got access to the data and the figures that he needs to be fair to that side of it? Is he in a position to...
to be fair to the Chancellor, he is waiting for a forecast and OBR figures that will drive his calculations, and then he will make, and his government will make, the determinations of what they do around tax and spending, which has the clear knock-on consequences for the Scottish budget through spending, Barnett consequentials, block grant adjustment, and of course our relative tax position. as well. So he is waiting for the OBR forecasts. He could take fiscal measures before the autumn statement, but he's chosen not to and leave it all to the autumn statement. And I contrast that, I suppose, with the interventions around monetary policy, contrasting with the actions on fiscal policy, which we have, I say, no further thoughts from the UK government on what they propose to do. Now, if we're speaking in the spirit of being fair to them, they are waiting for that economic data to drive their decisions. But it would be, I think, fair to say to the Scottish Government, we need to hold back to see what the implications of that would be. I mean, Alistair, do you want to add to that in terms of Chancellor's interventions?
I think the points that you make are right. You refer to the monetary policy intervention, which was quick from the Bank of England. But the Chancellor, as you say, will be waiting for some actual data on which OBR can base their trend forecasts for next year.
Can I make one further point? I suppose it is pertinent just to say that I've engaged further with the Chancellor on other matters, and I'll continue to pursue the UK Government on this timetable and substance issue because I know how important it is to the committee and to the Government.
Okay, thank you. Well, I think we explored the sort of background well enough. Alec, do you want to start off questions around? I've got a number of people who will pull in around issues on timing.
Thank you very much, Convener. We're, I suppose, both in an almost impossible situation. But from the committee point of view, we need to scrutinise the budget effectively. We would like to see the process running to a much earlier timescale. But it's becoming increasingly difficult to see how that can be achieved. However, you've made offers, suggestions, that there are ways that elements of this can be brought forward and the committee's work can be carried on in certain ways and an earlier timescale. Could you try and flesh out what the possibilities are and what that would look like, perhaps imagining what it would look like from the committee point of view and how that would compare with a normal scrutiny process?
I think that's a very fair question, and I understand that other committees, subject committees, might be looking at their pre-budget scrutiny in any event, so it is for committees to consider what they would like to probe in terms of current budgets and current practice, current priorities and issues around that. And I appreciate the difficulty of the committee and wanting to scrutinise a budget, but I don't want to publish a budget that is inaccurate, and I know will be inaccurate, and waste committee and parliament time on that. But what I think could be produced that may be of assistance could include information such as a statement on new portfolio budgets for this financial year. And I'll tell you why that's important, because with the new government, with the change in portfolios, of course there's been a realignment of budgets in the current year, and I think that that would be something useful for the committee to consider. I don't think it's had that degree of parliamentary exposure. So I think looking at current budgets and priorities within each portfolio would be of interest following the election of this government. Also, we could look at providing information about performance against national outcomes and the contribution made by expenditure programmes, again, an area that the committee has been interested in the past. We could provide an update on the fiscal framework along the lines that the committee may be interested in the current operation and ongoing work in there. And I could also suggest, if the committee wish, further work on the updated economic and financial modelling, to provide the committee with analysis to demonstrate the potential impact that changes in economic performance could have on the Scottish budget. So there's some ideas from a government perspective that are substantial items that I think the Finance Committee could be interested in.
I'm fully aware that the Cabinet Secretary is always willing to speculate, but I can understand why he may not be willing to speculate on elements of the budget before the information is available, certainly in a public context. But correct me if I'm wrong, did I get the impression from your opening statement that you are suggesting that you may be willing to discuss some elements of the budget, perhaps in private with the committee, at a point in time in advance of when you were willing to speak publicly?
I think the budget process has to be transparent. So I think at the point I'm ready to publish a draft budget, that has to go through that process. What I'm trying to do is share as much as I can about what we do know, about the kind of modelling and information that the committee would find of use. But there's a separate dialogue that this will be my first year of undertaking this with interesting parliamentary arithmetic, which is that political parties are perfectly entitled to bring to me what their demands or interests or priorities are around the budget process. My door is open to that, to have that conversation about what political parties may be interested in. But in terms of the budget process, I'm happy for officials to work with your clerks to have been able to produce something that can be scrutinised, but short of a budget, because I don't want to produce a budget that I know will be wrong, and that will be a waste of everyone's energy.
As the Cabinet Secretary is fully aware, the timescale that he's adopting and the timescale for the committee's scrutiny are now at a point where the system is almost dysfunctional if we go ahead on that basis. Do you think you can take us forward enough, and at what point do you think you'll be able to give us some information that would allow us to properly scrutinise the budget before it's too late?
Let me be clear to Mr. Johnston. I will not have a draft budget to scrutinise until I have the data that's required from the Chancellor's autumn statement. Now, we're trying to do this by agreement, but I can't produce a budget to be scrutinised without having the relevant knowledge from what the Chancellor is about to do in the autumn statement, for all the reasons of great detail that we can go into. But short of that, I think we can work together to come up with effective scrutiny of the issues that we're facing.
Okay. Okay. I've got a number of people who want to come in this area, and others who've indicated since we had a discussion earlier, so I'll try to get the balance right here. James.
Thank you, Convener. As I understand the position, Cabinet Secretary, and I'm sure you'll correct me if I'm misrepresenting you in any way, your position is that you have a genuine concern around publishing a budget on the normal timetables because of the variables in the current political process, and you're nervous about publishing an early budget, and you would prefer to wait until after the autumn statement, at which time you'll have more information available, and from your point of view, the budget will be more accurate. Do you accept that in any budget process that there are iterations, and that from you publish any draft budget, whether it is in October or December, the figures will ultimately change until the final budget is agreed by Parliament?
I accept that in previous years there has been some changes, but I think that largely there's been consequential increases has been a trend arising from the Chancellor's autumn statement. I don't get a sense that that's what's about to happen in this Chancellor's autumn statement. If you look at all the economic forecasts and the impact, for example, that Brexit will have on the economy and therefore tax receipts and therefore public expenditure, and there's consensus around the economic impact and then what that leads to. So I think we are in uncharted territory around this. Now, my starting position actually was to pick up from where the previous Finance Committee had left off. That was my starting position. In recognising that the previous Finance Committee had said in its legacy paper that we had to address the fact that the Scottish Parliament's powers had changed from inception. We're no longer just a spending parliament, we're a tax and spending parliament. So we haven't changed the working agreement or processes fully to reflect that, and that was my starting position. It then was the issue, yes, of course we want to be able to make tax decisions that don't encourage the wrong kind of cultural behaviours in terms of how people pay their tax and forestalling and so on. So there's that issue of concern as well that has to be addressed. But the bigger issue, I suppose, is the unknowns of what the Chancellor's about to do from what's happened in Brexit. There isn't the precedent of that. It's created such financial uncertainty that it's changed circumstances completely and recognising all of that, the previous Finance Committee's legacy paper on how we need to change our processes and look at timescales so that decisions can be closer to forecast as a sensible approach. Look at the fact we're now a tax and spending parliament with the new powers coming our way. We are dependent on forecast to change all of that and then deal with the uncertainty has led me to the conclusion that publishing an inaccurate budget would be the wrong thing to do. And the starting position of knowing it is about to change and having such intense scrutiny on a budget that would be subject to so much change because of the variables would be the wrong approach, in my opinion, Mr. Kelly.
Thank you. What would you regard as a material change in the budget? If you produced a draft budget in October and then the autumn statement was produced, say, in late November, and you had to update your draft budget to reflect some changes, what would you regard as a material change in the figures to substantially undermine your budget process the way that you the way that you've explained?
Sensitivities around potential income tax changes because of how our income tax policy relates to UK income tax policy, that could be subject to change. Spending commitments from the UK government and the spending review could be subject to change. The economic forecast could be subject to change. We don't know what the impact will be on the block grant adjustment. These are unknowns. And because they're unknowns, I don't know what the scale of adjustment is going to be. But you know, I can quote from a great many people who say, you know, that the scale of uncertainty is unknown. I mean, even might not be close to Mr. Kelly, but even Ruth Davidson, leader of the Conservative Party, just yesterday said, we know that there will be an impact on the economy because of the EU referendum. We do not know the scale of that, but as the Prime Minister said at the weekend, we should prepare for difficult times ahead. So I don't know the scale of financial adjustment that the Chancellor may have in mind, but the economic consensus is that there will be a negative impact on the economy, and this will inevitably feed through to the fiscal decisions. And it is of good governance and sound approach of this committee to want decisions to be based on the best and most recent estimates.
You're running, say, a budget in the range of £30 billion. What figure do you regard as a material change to undermine your budgeting process? Is it 100 million, 500 million, a billion, 1.5 billion?
Even with the scale of the Parliament and the government's budget, of course, to extract or change budget lines to the tune of 100 or hundreds of millions of pounds is a material change. You know, that's a significant sum and would require readjustment to any budget proposition. Of course it would. But what we don't know is, with all the variables in play, what the scale of change looks like.
So a change of 100 million, which we've seen in previous budget processes, you're saying is a material change in circumstances?
I'm saying that if, with the variable factors that we have, with the income tax position, the spending review position, with the new tax powers we have, and bear in mind, of course, with our devolved taxes, it's a far more complex position in the levers that we have and the spending commitments that we may choose to make. So yes, I do think that a change of hundreds of millions of pounds is of material significance, yes.
Would you accept that, you know, the measure of materiality of 1% in accountancy terms, which some accountants would use, is a reasonable one?
But equally, Mr. Kelly, would you accept that in embarking on a process, knowing your budget is wrong and your starting position is already potentially out by hundreds of millions of pounds, is a good starting position, really?
Well, I would put it to you that you've got to look at the measure of materiality, and the measure of materiality that I would use is if it's greater than 1% on your budget. Anyway, moving on, Mr. Mackay, just
can
one.
Can we get your last one? Can we move on to other people as well?
Yeah, sure. Briefly then, Mr. Mackay, just in terms of budget scrutiny, you said that you were previously a member of the committee, and I know you were very active in that regard. How important do you think is the role of subject committees, and based on a curtailed timetable, how do you feel subject committees can actively engage with the budget on a shortened process?
Yeah, Mr. Kelly's right. I do value parliamentary scrutiny. I think it makes for a better process. And I think that's why the starting position should be to produce something that's well-informed and accurate so that what we're scrutinising is actually robust. And I think in these exceptional circumstances, it would be for committees to look at their programme and say, could they work differently or radically? I'm happy to meet more often with committees, make officials available as well. But these are exceptional circumstances. But I want that period of intense scrutiny to be robust and to be accurate. And therefore, if we have to do things differently, I'm certainly up for that.
Supplementary in this area, then we're going to come to Patrick and then
I. Just a very brief follow-up to the questions about materiality that Mr. Kelly was pursuing. Can you remind us, Finance Secretary, what was the Scottish Government's underspend in the last financial year?
There was, in terms of the 150. Yeah, it was around 150 in terms of what of what we carried forward in different categories.
150 million, and in terms of previous years, that was more or less in that ballpark, was it? Yeah, it was 150 million up or down.
Yeah,
it was
around
years.
About 0.5%. Yeah.
So you're used to carrying, you know, perhaps 1% of the overall budget forward from the previous year.
Well, it's been less than that, but yes.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Can I just bring you back to the letter that you sent to the committee in June, on June 23rd, in which you set out the range of factors that give rise to uncertainty and which lead you to the view that late publication of the budget would be desirable. Is it fair to say that of those range of factors, since the 23rd of June, in fact, in the days after that, the prospect of policy change by the UK government has become a bigger factor, but that on reflection, the other factors that led to some prospect of uncertainty have receded and are likely to be more marginal in terms of their impact on the Scottish budget?
I think that's fair commentary. I, as I tried to describe earlier, was embarking on the journey that the Finance Committee, previous Finance Committee, suggested we embark upon to look again at the working agreement and the practices for scrutinising and determining the budget. Yes. So, what I was some of the new powers are coming. So, with those new powers coming, I felt that it was certainly worth exploring the new processes going forward. But the game changer, yes. In terms of the levels of uncertainty, has been the vote on Brexit and the economic impact.
The thing is, what you wrote in that letter, when you were looking at these range of different forms of uncertainty, was, I recognise there may be a range of views about the budget timetable, and I'm very open to discussing them. And you looked at the advantages of more parliamentary scrutiny versus the disadvantage of uncertainty. Now, it seems to me that UK government policy change is always a possibility in the run-up to an autumn budget statement. In every year, it will be a possibility. Should we, as Parliament, be willing to accept the view of government that possibility is always a reason for late publication of budgets and for subject committees effectively to have the last week of term before Christmas and the first week of term after Christmas as the only opportunities to take evidence on the budget?
No, that's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying to Mr. Harvey is I think we should look through the working group, and I think that's a very welcome development, look through the working group for what works for everyone going forward in terms of the new powers we have, all the forecasts, all the drivers, and the proper need for scrutiny. So I think we need to address all of those factors in the longer term. But for this year, we are facing an unprecedented economic challenge because of the Brexit vote. And therefore, I am convinced from all the statements, some of which I've referenced, that there will be a major financial adjustment that will have an inevitable knock-on consequence to the government's budget. And I think that for this year, in these exceptional circumstances, we should set out on a timescale that follows the Chancellor's autumn statement.
I think, for the longer term,
I agree, we need to address all the different issues within that.
I think we all accept that there will be an inevitable knock-on effect on the Scottish Government's budget, but the uncertainty arising from late publication also means an inevitable knock-on effect on all other public bodies in Scotland that the Scottish Government's budget funds. And in the absence of a draft budget, surely they're more likely to be drawn to worst-case scenario planning than if there is a budget that sets out a range of possibilities. Can I suggest to you that the bare minimum that's needed is some detailed scenario planning that's put into the public domain before the draft budget publication and before subject committees are asked to undertake what we are pleased to call pre-budget scrutiny, which therefore is not budget scrutiny. Some detailed scenario planning would allow subject committees and the Finance Committee to consider what actually are the government's priorities in terms of mirroring UK tax rates or in terms of the commitments that we've heard yesterday to £500 million on energy efficiency or £500 million on the growth scheme or other infrastructure investments or anything from that to the baby box. All of our subject committees need to understand what will be the impact of various scenarios that the Scottish Government may face over the coming months and what its reaction is going to be in order to conduct any kind of meaningful scrutiny. Are you able to put that kind of scenario planning into the public domain?
And on that issue of that scenario planning suggestion that Patrick Harvey's put forward, is that something also that could be brought into the discussion between your officials and the clerks about what additional material might be produced for the committee to help undertake appropriate scrutiny and as much transparency as can be achieved?
I recognise the issues that committee members are wrestling with, so yes, I'll try and produce as much as possible that helps that along. It would have to be very responsible scenario planning, because people are watching Scotland with these new powers, our fiscal responsibility, and indeed the projections we make. So I want to do things that, you know, support our message and our economic credibility as well. So I think it would have to be very responsible scenario planning, but I would want to inform that so that if UK government takes certain actions, what does that mean for our budget and our budget process? And I'll make some other comments in relation to what Mr. Harvey has asked as well. I entirely appreciate the impact in agencies and organisations and partners financially supported by Scottish Government waiting on their figures. But I go back to the point that I want that to be an accurate reflection of our budget position. And it goes back to Mr. Kelly's point about material change. It isn't as simple as you would think just to take out a few hundred million pounds from the government's budget. That's actually quite significant and very sensitive approach and issues that are in play there. There is a statement of government's intent around the manifesto that we want to deliver. The First Minister's programme for government just yesterday. And Mr. Harvey makes a very interesting point around, you know, our tax position, wanting to know what we would do to mirror the UK's tax position. Exactly. Yes, but therein lies a key point. How can you mirror a tax position if you don't know what the tax position is? And I suspect there will be change in the Chancellor's autumn statement. And it's a very fair point, because with income tax powers and with the block grant adjustment, the decisions we take around income tax don't just raise revenue, but also relative to what the rest of the UK government does, could lose revenue. Therefore, it's entirely interlinked with what the UK government chooses to do. But the spirit of the question is, am I willing to produce as much as I can towards scenario planning? Yes, but it'll have to be responsible to ensure that it doesn't then open up all the difficulties with producing inaccurate information that I'm trying to avoid with an inaccurate budget.
Just briefly, Convener, I would just like to suggest on the record that it would assist not just this committee but all our colleagues on subject committees if the Cabinet Secretary was able to say in the very near future what the timescale for the publication of that kind of scenario planning will be, to allow them to build that scrutiny into their work plans.
Point, and the Cabinet Secretary's heard the point. Now, I'm trying to get everybody in, and we've still got time. So, Ivan McKee, I said I'd come to you next, Ash Denham, and then I'll come to Adam.
Thanks, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, I've been thinking about this for the last few weeks and trying to understand it, and you can maybe help me with that. Relating it back to my experience in business, so forgive me if I take a wee kind of detour. In the business environment, clearly you've got to set budgets, you've got to deal with uncertainty, that's the nature of the beast, things happen, and you get on with the process. But clearly there are situations you get into, and I've been in them myself on many occasions, where you know something is coming along, a known unknown, if you want to call it that, that's substantial enough that you have to do something differently. And very often I've seen companies push back their year ends, etc., and able to understand the nature of that situation, be it a merger or an acquisition or some major change in the customer environment or something like that. So those situations do happen. And I suppose part of my question is to understand which side of the line do you see this on? Is it business as usual, or is a known unknown there of such magnitude that, to kind of mix metaphors, yeah, we can sail forward and we'll deal with choppy water, but if we know there's an iceberg there, it doesn't make sense to carry on as business as usual until we can see a bit more clearly what the scope and scale of that is. And just following on from some other comments that have been made around about committees, I mean, I sit on the Health and Sport Committee, which my understanding is the biggest spender. And frankly, the idea of spending two or three sessions over the autumn engaging in what you might call fantasy budgets until we actually get some real numbers doesn't fill me with inspiration. I'd rather wait and see what we're actually going to talk about rather than waste time going around the houses on something that's a waste of time. So I don't know if you maybe clarify in terms of the scale and scope of this thing, which of those sort of scenarios you feel, based on the evidence we're looking at?
Mr. McKee raises a valid point, but I have to say, if I knew how big the uncertainty was, it wouldn't be uncertainty. It wouldn't be uncertain. So it is difficult to answer that.
The nature of it, rather,
yeah, there are so many variables and so much uncertainty in play, it is hard to pin down the scale. As I say, even the Chancellor concedes that he's unwilling to make decisions before he has the OBR figures. You know, if he's unwilling to make decisions on an autumn statement, how can I be expected to produce an entire budget without that starting position from the Chancellor in terms of the change that is now expected caused from the Brexit vote and the economic turbulence? Notwithstanding the fact, and I don't think we should lose sight of this, that your previous committee said we had to address the issue of forecasts and being a different kind of parliament than the one that was created when the FIAG principles were established.
Ash, and then Adam, and then Neil.
Good morning. I'd like to explore what's happening on this issue in other parts of the UK. So you've touched on this a little bit already. So in Northern Ireland, they had been planning to produce a multi-year budget, but just in the last couple of days, they've obviously changed that position. And they've now decided to just do a one-year budget. And the finance minister has been quoted as saying that the budget cannot be put together until the Chancellor, Philip Hammond's autumn statement, because of its likely knock-on consequences for the Stormont-Lock grant. And I think I'm right in saying as well that in the Welsh have also had to make adjustments to their budget. So, you know, a budget delay here would not be unique to Scotland.
That's absolutely correct. And the difference between Scotland and the other devolved administration is we actually have more powers. We have more variables because of the fiscal framework, the agreement, the block grant adjustment. So we have even more uncertainty than those other devolved administrations, it could be argued. But you're right to say that the Northern Ireland administration, and I have engaged with their finance minister, will not be proceeding pre-autumn statement for, I think, very sensible reasons. Wales may choose a different course. They have different issues at play. Maybe they will want to pursue a budget and have the Tory government reopen that and then have someone to point to if they have to do that. But certainly Northern Ireland, for the reasons similar to our own, but we've got these extra variables as well, is not proceeding as you described. And I think that shows the consensus around not making any rash decisions before the autumn statement.
Adam.
Thank you very much. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Clearly what we're talking about here, and it's not the first time we've talked about it since the election, what we're talking about here is a trade-off between two different values, both of which are in the public interest. The first is the value of accurate budget forecasts and accurate draft budgets. and we've heard you say quite a lot about the importance of accuracy this morning. But the second, which I know that you also believe in as passionately as I do, is the public good in effective and robust parliamentary scrutiny. And what you're asking the committee to agree to, so far as I understand it, and correct me if I'm wrong, is to privilege the accuracy of draft budgets and of forecasts over the public good of effective and robust parliamentary scrutiny. And I just want to understand a little bit more on the record about exactly what kind of cut into effective parliamentary scrutiny you're asking for. So you're saying that you won't produce a draft budget until after the autumn statement. I asked you in June how long it would take you to produce a draft budget after the autumn statement, and the answer from you and your officials was at least 3 weeks. If the autumn statement is at the end of November or beginning of December, as we expect, therefore, given the Christmas recess, we're not expecting to see a draft budget until the new year. I also asked you in June whether we could elongate the other end of the process so that we'd have more time into the spring to consider the draft budget. And the answer is that we really can't do that for various reasons that we can't shift. So you're asking us, as I understand it, is this right, Cabinet Secretary, to consider the entirety of the draft budget and budget from the initial publication of the draft to the passing of the budget bill in a matter of about 7 or 8 weeks, from the from early January until late February?
Okay, that's helpful. It's not just Mr. Tompkins that has been thinking about the budget process for the last few weeks and months. It's obviously been playing on all of our minds. You know, there is to give much more certainty, you know, the one man who could give us much more certainty in all of this would be the Chancellor. If the Chancellor laid out that Scotland's budget would be untouched and they were going to do nothing different to what they had said they would do on income tax, we'd have far more clarity. So this could be resolved at the stroke of a pen by the Chancellor in terms of material impact on Scotland's budget. But that said, you see, I've got a different view, I suppose, on what effective scrutiny looks like in this respect, that I think a credible budget is far more worth scrutinising than a budget that is inaccurate. And that is why I think effective scrutiny, as Mr. Tompkins describes it, would be a credible, accurate budget based on the most recent forecast and decision from the UK government following from the autumn statement. In terms of options, though, within that, I do support probity and proper parliamentary scrutiny. And therefore, I do think the Parliament and its committees should work with us constructively to think differently about what happens in that period of draft publication, right through the processes of the Parliament. Could committees meet more frequently? Could they have additional sittings? Could they call ministers? You know, there are different things we could do if that's the will of Parliament. So it's not just about the length of time, but what effective scrutiny looks like during that period of publication. And I did explore the extension at the other side of the budget process, but that was incredibly difficult because of the stakeholders and the partners that are relying on the budget, and also the legislative process within Parliament, Royal Assent and so on. So there's serious issues why you wouldn't want to extend it at the other end of the process, but I think we should be radical as to what we could look at beyond publication of a draft budget. And I did commit to producing a budget as quickly as possible after the Chancellor's autumn statement. The timing for his statement is not in my gift, but we would work incredibly hard to achieve that 3-week period, and that was also because we would rely on some of the work from the Scottish Fiscal Commission, and that's really important to have that as part of the process. So 3 weeks would be challenging, but that's what I would try and do to ensure that the draft budget is published before Christmas. You know, Merry Christmas, everyone, but I would commit to that. But I go back to the Northern Ireland point, who are not proposing to produce, as far as I understand it, before Christmas, so it will be into the new year. I'm saying I will do it as swiftly as we possibly can, which would have set a target of 3 weeks after Chancellor's autumn statement, and that is challenging.
I think reading across from the consociational arrangements of the Northern Ireland Assembly, where there is no government in opposition, to the arrangements we have here in the Scottish Parliament, where we have minority government and clearly government in opposition, is dangerous. I mean, one can overstretch that. The our independent advisor, working with Spice, has advised us, Cabinet Secretary, that the changes to the Scottish budget that are likely to have to be made after the autumn statement are, and these are the words that have been used in the documentation, which I think is on the committee's website, relatively minor, marginal, and limited. And this is why James Kelly and others have been talking with you about, you know, exactly what kind of changes that we're talking about. So our advice, the committee's advice, is that the changes that you would need to make post the autumn statement are relatively minor, marginal, and limited, and yet you are asking for a massive curtailment of parliamentary time in terms of the extent of the period available for this parliament to scrutinise your draft budget and the subsequent budget. It seems to me that, again, if you're thinking about trade-offs, and you're thinking about not only the likelihood of the risk of inaccuracy, but also the magnitude of the harm that would be done to Scottish democracy by this parliament not being able to scrutinise your budget proposals effectively, that you're asking for something which is perhaps going a little further than is necessary.
Well, I disagree on two points. First of all, that any adjustments would be minor or easy. I don't know if you've got greater, or anyone has greater insight into what the Chancellor's about to do than the Chancellor. Therefore, I think it's very difficult for any spectator to say that what I will do will be minor or easy. You know, if the Chancellor can't produce his autumn statement without the OBR forecast, how can I be expected to produce an entire Scottish budget in that form? So I don't think it'll be minor or easy. I think the Scottish budget's very complex, even more complex now with the new powers and the interplay with the UK government decisions as well. It is very complex, I'm sure, as all members of the committee would understand. And I just take a different view on effective scrutiny, I suppose, that I think that effective scrutiny is best served by having the best up-to-date position and knowing far more than we know pre-autumn statement. And I think then what the committee will be asked to study is a more accurate, credible document and proposition from which we negotiate with the parliamentary arithmetic and is scrutinised. And I'm happy for that to be even more intensively scrutinised than has been the case in the past in light of circumstances. But I do again say I think it'd be wrong to publish pre-autumn statement, and I suppose we just have a difference in opinion on that. But I don't think it's undermining Parliament to want to present the best that I have.
Different parliaments do with the budget scrutiny, and they've said that the ideal seems to be that parliaments are enabled to scrutinise budgets and draft budgets for a period of between 3 and 4 months, and that's what happens in places like Canada and Denmark and all sorts of other good places. So, and just to make sure that I do understand this, you're asking us to agree to a timetable that is less than half of what the OECD have recognised as best practice?
Mr. Tompkins, I think I'll need to check whether the OECD studied independent nations or devolved administrations within those arrangements, so I'm happy to check that point. But you're right, the United Kingdom Westminster Parliament has amongst, if not the worst, in terms of parliamentary scrutiny of the budget process. So it's not something I'd want to emulate, but I think we have to get the balance right in Scotland. And that's exactly why I want to support the working group, so that we can co-design the best possible system for the future, but we are in unprecedented circumstances for this financial year.
Thank you.
Mr. Harvey mentioned earlier that some of the financial commitments made in the programme for government yesterday, £100 million in capital projects, £4 billion in infrastructure next year, £3 billion planned for housing over this parliament, £500 million for energy efficiency over the next 3 years, £90 million over the next year for broadband, £3.5 million for new innovation hubs, biggest ever R&D grant, half a billion Scottish Growth Fund, obviously attainment fund, £250 million each year from the NHS to social care partnerships, protecting police revenue budgets, in real terms, £100 million extra over the next term in the parliament. Now, I presume they're all going to be in your budget, because you'd be in trouble if they weren't. Can we expect, as a committee, any further information on spending commitments if you're not producing a budget before you do so, and can we expect any further spending announcements?
I think it's a very fair question. Mr. Bibby's right to ask, and I thank him for just outlining just some of the highlights from yesterday's programme for government. And if even the Labour Party members are proud in listing the proposed direction of travel from this government, then we're doing not too bad, as we say in the west of Scotland. So in terms of the question, if you take one, I think, significant issue, such as the Scottish Growth Scheme, I have immediately engaged with the committee on that by writing to the convener so that that can be discussed in terms of how we take that forward in the detail. The government is entitled and indeed expected to, in its programme for government, outline how we will deliver our manifesto commitments, and that's what we are doing. And of course, the programme for government is interlinked with the budget that I would propose. And naturally, I, as I've referenced earlier, and members have a role to play in this as well, I will have to get a budget passed for the government to be able to deliver its manifesto and its programme for government. And that is a matter of parliamentary arithmetic. But of course, I'll continue to work constructively with the committee to share information on proposals, propositions in any budgetary matters that you may be interested in, as well as the existing infrastructure in the Parliament, such as the revisions to the budgets themselves, which is twice yearly, and the various financial and fiscal orders that I'll have to undertake, as well as the new orders that will be required as part of the new powers from the Scotland Act 2016.
In terms of the amount of detail you've given so far, there's obviously an argument that you could go further in terms of giving more detail. But the just to follow up what Ivan McKee was asking about the health budget and not wanting to gauge in fantasy budgets, and health being the largest spending committee, you've given a manifesto commitment to protect the NHS budget. Surely that's going to be maintained in your budget. You don't need to give us all the details, but if the biggest spending commitment in the budget is health, and you've given a commitment to protecting that spending, surely then we could see a lot more detail on what the NHS budget is going to be doing over the next year.
So I think you'll be aware then, Mr. Bibby, of the detail around the NHS commitment, indeed all the commitments in the manifesto. I'm sure you've read it from cover to cover, but in the NHS, that's right, there was agreement about real terms protection, passing on consequentials, and overall an above inflation increase of £500 million by the end of the Parliament. So that's the kind of thing we've committed to in the manifesto, and yes, in terms of budget delivery, that's the kind of policy that I would pursue.
So, for example, the health budget, if you're going to follow through on that commitment to protect the NHS budget in the next budget, there's no reason why we need to see a delay in scrutiny of what the NHS budget is going to look like.
Well, what I'm outlining is the manifesto commitment on protection and health this government intends to deliver. What I cannot present to you now, for all the reasons we've explored this morning, is the government's draft budget. But we still intend to deliver that manifesto commitment.
Marie.
Good morning. I'm very new to this committee, so I'm struggling a little bit to understand the question mark, the issue of delay in the draft budget. It seems to me very clear that there has been a hugely significant event over the summer, which is likely to have a very big impact on finances. It seems to me very clear that you need accurate figures in order to do your budget. It seems to me that the figures which are in March are very likely to be superseded very soon by new figures, more accurate. I've looked at the last 5 years where there wasn't very much variance. I would say we're more likely to be in the sort of situation that we were in, say, 2008, where there was a huge change over the course of the summer. So the figures came out in March and were vastly different by November. Just look at the sits. There was, in the UK spring budget in 2008, the prediction for income tax receipts was to grow by 6.8%. And actually in November, when the forecast came out, there was a fall of income tax receipts, down by 3.5%. So there was a 10.3% change between March and November. Between, yeah. And I suspect that's the situation that we're in at the moment. I'm just wondering if you have any confidence in the likelihood of there being that, if you have any idea of the likely scale of change that's going to come from March to November this year.
Yeah, I actually think that characterisation of the issue was pretty accurate from a member that thinks that they haven't grasped the issue. I thought that was probably better than my notes express it anyway. But I think the point around the last few years, there has been, I suppose, relative economic stability compared to the current position around Brexit and compared to the financial crash. So I can't put a range on the scale of financial adjustment that might be undertaken. I think we're in the area of substantial, because of the range of variables, substantial adjustment as opposed to a bit of tweaking here or there. But that commentary on adjustments over the last few years have been largely through a period of relative economic stability where Barnett consequentials were on the increase, but set in the context of real terms reductions to the Scottish Government's budget, which has been the case since about 20, looking at the period from 2010, the figures of real terms reductions, and that real terms reduction, by all accounts, is likely to continue.
Am I right in understanding that that change has already been signalled? I mean, didn't the outgoing Chancellor said that there would be a punishment budget? And the current Chancellor says that he's going to reset the economy. So we've been told that there are likely to be big changes coming.
I'd like to say that the previous Chancellor warned that there would be an emergency budget and made comments around, based on Treasury modelling and others, around impact from Brexit. The new Chancellor has said he will, and I'm quoting, reset fiscal policy, whatever that means. That can mean something substantial, but it's in his gift. So if he's looking at the economic forecast, and I'm sure and I know that he is, but he's waiting for the OBR to conclude his position and then determine which economic and fiscal levers to pull. But his interventions thus far have been simply to where he has responsibility, react to the Bank of England's monetary interventions rather than fiscal interventions. Now, that's coming in the autumn statement.
Cabinet Secretary, one of the things that's been exercising me since about 10 o'clock when I became the convener is the fact that, you know, you and I are both former council leaders. I'm sure there'll be other people who've been councillors or done other things in their lives when the public service budget matters greatly to them in terms of how they go about their job. And I mentioned to others in private before we began that one of my concerns is if we produce a budget at this stage, which turns out to be inaccurate and has got a level of variance which is at 200 million or more, then the impact on other organisations out in Scotland could be significant. But if we produce a budget in October, from my experience, if that was to happen, then council leaders all across Scotland would begin to scenario plan on that budget, which, and begin to build some certainties into the organisation about what they might do. But of course, the potential is that might change significantly. How, from your experience, how turbulent do you think that could be, not just for local authorities, but for all the other non-departmental public bodies which are the Scottish Government's responsible for? Because it's not just about this committee, it's not just about the government, it's also about how wider Scotland deals with the issue of the budget.
Dina, I remember being a council leader and having to revisit budgets mid-year, actually, as a consequence of the downturn. And that was a difficult process, naturally. It is. That's why you want the best possible certainty as you embark on the budget process. Many councils will be working on it at the moment. They will be modelling scenarios. And engagements I've had with COSLA and indeed other local authorities, I've been able to share as much as I know about the UK spending decisions and timetabling. And I think they will be modelling on a range of scenarios, and they will also have looked at the commitments of the Scottish Government as well from the manifesto. So I think they will be preparing, but they would far prefer, I can tell you, a credible draft budget that's accurate than one that's inaccurate, because it is incredibly difficult to then go back and unpick, you know, portfolio budgets and potentially a settlement to local government, to unpick that. Now, Parliament has primacy because Parliament will vote on the budget and either approve it or not. And it's that parliamentary arithmetic that's important. And therefore, local government will have to watch very carefully what Parliament chooses to do. But in any discussions and negotiations I have with local government, they'll want that degree of accuracy and certainty, which I can only give post-autumn statement.
I know that Murdo wanted to ask a question which is not directly related to the discussion we've been having, but it was related to the budget, to do with the growth scheme issue. Do you want to deal with that now, Murdo?
Thank you, Commissioner. It's something, in relation to something you've mentioned a couple of times this morning, Finance Secretary, the Scottish growth scheme, which was announced yesterday in the programme for government, which you wrote to the convener about yesterday in more detail. Clearly, it's a substantial and significant measure in the Scottish Government's programme yesterday to promote the economy. Indeed, it's probably the most significant economic measure, amounting to £500 million of loan guarantees. It's also on the front page of a number of the newspapers this morning, so clearly the Scottish Government have been promoting that as a key part of their programme to support the economy. You do say in your letter that this will require Treasury support because it requires additional AME budget cover. Can I ask you what discussions you've had with the Treasury about whether or not this support will be forthcoming?
No conversations with them on this specifically before bringing it to Parliament. We've given Parliament the courtesy of knowing first, but I have written to the Chief Secretary to the Treasury at the same time as writing to the Finance Convener. And I hope that the UK Treasury will be cooperative around this, because it is no financial call upon UK government, but if delivered is, as Murdo Fraser has pointed out, of great assistance to the business community in Scotland and will be managed by the Scottish Government, and we'll engage with businesses as well as this committee on the operation of the scheme.
With respect to Cabinet Secretary, is this a responsible way in which to proceed? Because this is clearly the centrepiece of the programme for government in terms of its economic support, announced with great fanfare yesterday, and yet now it appears you've had no discussions at all with the Treasury as to whether or not this will have their support. Surely you should not have had a conversation with them, or at least your officials have a conversation in advance with Treasury to try and understand whether support would be forthcoming before announcing it with such fanfare.
I'm sure that the UK government, with its alleged support for the business community, will want to support the Scottish Government to deliver such a scheme. Should we not come to Parliament to engage with Scottish parliamentarians on such matters? And I have to say that Murdo Fraser is well aware that the UK Government often makes decisions that impact on Scotland and our budget and our businesses without engaging with the Scottish Government first. And I could list examples where that has been the case, like the apprenticeship levy or other levies. So it is the case that the government of Scotland can pursue our policy objectives. Now, I welcome the fact that Murdo Fraser believes it to be the centrepiece of the programme for government. I think that's good commentary, because it is a significant intervention to support our economy at this time. I think it shows innovative thinking on the part of this government and how we will use the strength of our balance sheet to support Scotland's economy. And I would ask all members of the committee and all political parties to support us in pursuing this and progressing it. And I see no good reason why the UK government won't want us to proceed with this and support us on this. In fact, I wouldn't be surprised if they copy it.
One more question, if I may, Convener, because Cabinet Secretary, you've just spent the last hour telling us that your hands are tied in terms of publishing a budget and making any financial decisions in relation to the Scottish budget, because you're waiting on information from the UK Treasury. Now you've just told us that you can go ahead, gleefully publish an ambitious scheme, which may or may not be of great benefit to the economy, but have had no conversation with the Treasury at all before doing so. Can you not see the clear contradiction in what is said in this letter and what you've been telling us for the last hour?
Fraser wants to appreciate and understand the detail of how this will actually work in terms of the strength of
our... That wasn't my question with respect, Cabinet Secretary.
Well, it is actually. If you want to understand the detail of how this actually works, it's not the same as setting out a budget proposition because of the detail of how this will work within the annually managed expenditure limits. So it's a different context, but, you know, I suspect the Conservatives will back this particular measure, and I think if the UK Treasury has any
Should
sense,
you not have asked them
they will support it. Do you not respect Parliament, Mr. Fraser?
Thank you, Convener. Just again, following up on the announcement of this scheme, I don't have the First Minister's statement in front of me at the moment, but if I recall correctly, both before and after this scheme was announced, the First Minister was using the language of inclusive growth, fair work, decent terms and conditions for people. These kind of issues came up. There's been a range of ways in which the Scottish Government has tried to give encouragement, but the discussions at the Economy Committee in the last session showed that there was a degree of reluctance to build in real incentives. Can the Cabinet Secretary tell us how this scheme will promote, for example, the real living wage, low wage ratios, decent terms and conditions, employee ownership of businesses? How will this scheme be used to help build a fair and inclusive economy rather than just any kind of business goes?
Well, I think that's a very helpful point to make, and that's partly why I've written to the committee convener, primarily because of the working agreement, and that's how the guarantee schemes operate, around the £1 million limit at the moment. I think we need to explore how our scheme would work in terms of a revised working agreement, and I'm more than happy to engage on those kind of issues as we construct the scheme to take forward in dialogue with business and this committee with Treasury support. So these could be issues that we could consider. Mr. Harvey's absolutely right that we have taken forward many of the principles and practices that we would encourage, such as the living wage. So I'm happy to have that dialogue as we construct the fine detail of this scheme.
Nobody else has indicated they want to contribute. So thank you, Cabinet Secretary, and your officials for your appearance before the committee today. The committee will obviously now consider the issues raised during this evidence session in regard to the timetable for scrutiny of the 2017-18 budget and the budget review later in the meeting. And obviously, my clerks will be in touch with your officials on these matters, particularly around the issue that you raised yourself at the beginning and others explored with you around how we can get additional material that's as transparent and accountable as possible, and around the scenario planning issue in particular that Patrick Harvey mentioned. And I hope these discussions can prove to be fruitful. But thank you very much in the meantime. I now close this, move this meeting into private session. And we can take a break. For